This podcast is brought to you by Free Buddhist Audio, the Dharma for your life. Our work is funded entirely by donations from our generous listeners. If you would like to help us keep this free, make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. Thank you and happy listening.
So I would like to dedicate this talk to my teachers and my spiritual friends. And apart from all the obvious good reasons, there will also be, that might be even more clear in the talk why that is. And I'm giving a talk on chapter 4 and 5 in the Bodhicaryavatara. Yeah, sit back and relax. Yeah. I mean, one thing that is so apparent when you read the text, which Maitreya was really drawing out as well, is just how much humour you can find in the Bodhicaryavatara. Whether that was intended at the time or not, who knows, but it's definitely very funny to read it from our perspective. And I think most of us have tried something of the kind that Santideva comes across at the beginning of chapter 4, where it's basically like, oh shit, what have I done? Yeah. So it's quite interesting because I sort of think of Santideva a bit like an Italian opera. I've been using that expression a bit in the group. And some people seem to have an internal life that's like an Italian opera. Yeah, there's nothing that's small. Everything is like, if they're dying, it takes half an hour. Yeah, you know, we have an Italian nodding. No cultural stereotypes here. But it's like some people's internal lives really seem to be like Italian operas. Nothing is of a small nature. Everything is really intense. And it does sound like Santideva could have been of that inkling. Yeah. Well, if you have an internal life that's like an Italian opera, that is fine. That's what you got to work with. And if you have an internal life that might be a different cultural stereotype, that is also just what you got to work with. I've been hanging out in Finland quite a bit over my ordered life. And one of the most beautiful moments is sometimes when you see two Finnish people who you know really, really love each other, they meet. Because you know the love is there, but it looks very different from when I meet the Spanish order members who really love each other. And it's just different. It's just different, yeah. So I think the trick with this stuff is like whatever our internal life happens to be, well, that's what we got, yeah? So if you are not an Italian opera, just, you know, you can still get quite a bit from Santideva. And if you are, you just feel right at home. Just to say there's no rights or wrongs about this. It's just how we happen. It's our stuff. And sometimes the other person's stuff might be more exciting, but guess what? This is yours. That's what you've got to work with. Santideva, in his slightly Italian opera style, has really been like, you know, pumping up the wish for enlightenment. You know, I'm going to go for this. I'm really going to do this. Isn't it amazing? And then he wakes up sort of the next morning thinking, do I really want to do that? And isn't that great? Because I think what's so helpful when we have these moments is it gives us a chance to stop and think, oh, do I really want to do this? Well, partly because sometimes we might have said yes to things we don't actually want to do, or that is not helpful for us. That was a bit spur of the moment, caught by emotions, or, you know, I'm sure all of us are really pure beings that never go out and get drunk. But if any of us ever tried that and sort of made plans with friends about all the amazing things you would do when you were out being drunk, and then the next morning they're probably not going to happen, yeah? That's sort of given. But sometimes you might make plans with friends or your family or whatever at work and realize, actually, I'm not behind this. And that's really important to notice, because we are so caught by what other people want and think. And we so easily get drawn into stuff. So that, like, oh shit, what have I done? Just greet it with a lot of respect whenever it happens. because it's like an opportunity for awareness. That would be my take on it. I don't think Santideva quite says that in the text. He does say, well, we should consider what we take on. We really should consider what we take on. What's also very interesting is to remember all this. The whole point of this text is enlightenment. There's nothing other than enlightenment that is his goal. So in a way, making the result to gain enlightenment for the sake of all beings, that is quite a tall order. But it's also interesting to see what might come up when we make any sort of resource. Because he talks about laziness, in a way, can I be bothered? It's a bit hard gaining enlightenment for the sake of all beings, I'm not quite sure. You know, what I take from that text as well, which is not as clearly there, but I think we can find it, is also just the power of habit. You know, I normally do this. Oh, can't I just do that again? So one thing is being lazy, actually not gathering your energy. But also it's just, it's so much easier to do what we normally do. And I think there's a third aspect that stops us in our resources, sometimes doubt. And doubt is a really interesting thing because, well, doubt can be a lot of things. And doubt, in a way, is that sense of, do I know what I'm doing? Do I know why I'm making this resolve? Do I know how to make a resolve? Do I know why I'm making it? And yeah, he knows he's wanting to gain enlightenment for the sake of all beings. So he has the how or the why. And he's sort of using the text to say how. But I think that for us, there is something about reflecting on, if I don't do something, is it because I doubt the Dharma? Or is it because I might doubt myself? And they're quite interesting things to reflect on in my experience, like that sense of, do I doubt the Dharma? Do I actually believe that this stuff is going to lead me to enlightenment? Or what bits of it do I believe? And you might have come across the sort of the way of talking about doubts in Buddhism, which is not blind faith. It's based on intellectual understanding. It's based on a deep intuitive resonance, you could say, and it's based on direct experience. Yeah. So if you don't feel you actually trust the Dharma, well, is it because I don't know what the Dharma says? Is it like, do I don't know the what's the teachings? Have I not sort of made them my own? Do I feel, have I tested them in myself? And have I tested them in action? And it's really, it's quite interesting just doing that with some of the small Dharma teachings. If I practice mindfulness, does it work? Is it a good idea? So just checking, do I actually believe the Dharma? Or is this whole thing we put on, is that just one big prank? Yeah, so we probably don't believe that, but we might think, yeah, it's all very well. But, and just be curious if that happens to you. Yeah. You might not know what I'm talking about, but I can just tell you that has occurred from time to time in my practice. Just actually, what do I believe? Yeah. So sorting out, am I clear about what I want? Am I clear about how to go about it? And the other aspect that can be really tricky if we encounter doubt is, well, it's all very well for all the others. They are doing brilliantly and becoming these amazing people, but I'm still really horrible and useless. Yeah? That's slightly, again, the Italian opera style. But it's again and again and again, people seem to come up against in themselves. And this might not, again, be you, but for some people, it's one of the big stumbling blocks is noticing, oh, yeah, it's all very well. And I actually don't believe it'll work for me. For some reason, I'm so unique. I'm so stuck. I'm so messed up. I'm so hopeless that the Dharma is not going to work for me. And if that arises, just be kind and curious with it. Yeah. And I can just say the best antidote to that view, is practice, to be honest. Because the more you practice, the more doubt just falls away. And it is one of the first three fetters. So that sense of the more you practice, the more this stuff takes care of itself. And just to say, I think those oh shit moments are really interesting, because it's like it's an invitation to go beyond what we normally would like to do. And we do need to go beyond what we would normally like to do, because if we do what we normally do, we get the result we usually get. And we want a different result. We want enlightenment. We're not going to gain enlightenment unless we do something radically different. It's also, I mean, don't, you know, if you don't feel like jumping off a cliff, don't jump off a cliff, but see what's in the vicinity. What's just feels like, oh, that's a little bit. And I'll give you a small example, which is probably a little bit funny, but I do a fair bit amount of stuff up front, and I have done for most of my order life. So that's fine. And then Mahamani said, can we record you? And I was like, yeah, that's fine. And then I had that, oh shit. And that's because for years, I really, for all sorts of reasons, and partly circumstantial, I just wasn't recorded very much. And I made an effort to not be recorded. And then I thought a few years ago, oh, actually, it's okay now. I have a job where it's all right to be recorded, blah, 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 blah. And yet I have to sort of, it still was a little bit of a thing. But if I don't do it, if I don't practice being recorded, I'll never get at ease with it. And also, I feel really passionately about, you know, senior order members, women being out there, being recorded, being themselves, and being visible. So it's a little bit, okay, my personal preference of being a bit anonymous at times doesn't go along with my values. So I have to extend myself a bit to be, you know, to actually face up to, okay, if I want to live even more by my values, maybe I could just go out there where it's slightly uncomfortable. And guess what? I'm still here. You know, but that sense of those, did I really say that? You know, greet them and rejoice, because you're probably onto something. One thing I will say about making resolves as well is that they're actually really good practice. It's really good. Oh, do you want to sort that out? Is that all right? Cool. It's really good practice to figure out where can I extend myself a bit. And retreats are such a good opportunity, because it's like you're being reminded about what could the terrain be around your normal habits. What does it look like just, you know, over the fence sort of thing. So being on retreat, we might actually get quite inspired. Oh, I'm going to go home and I'm going to meditate every day. I'm going to go home and I only cook vegetarian food for my family. Yeah. So it could be things like that that might be your resolve. And just really honor those, honor them. It might be that, okay, you can't meditate every single day, but the resolve can still be there. And you, when you don't do it, you just start again the next day. Yeah. It might be that your teenage kids, they go in a complete flap and cook their own meals. Well, so be it. You know, if they, it's like that sense of actually finding out what would you like to keep doing. And it's very inspiring being with other people also practicing, because we will be met and reflected, and our values will resonate in a different way than when we're with other people. So So that's sort of from that chapter, really, we're about making a resolve. And also he does come around Santideva in his slightly da-da way and says, I am actually going to do this stuff. Yeah, lucky for us. Otherwise, the book might have been a bit short. So, yeah. Oh, actually, I have a few visual aids for this making a resolve thing. Because I guess what helps me, I'll just add that, what helps me so much when I think, oh no, I can't do that. Well, I can just say it's a real amazing thing to have spiritual friends. Yeah, and sometimes they might look at you a bit like this. Yeah, they're just not impressed. Yeah, so one of the things I notice with my teachers is they never buy into my stories. Like, as in never. So they might be, sometimes they're more like this. Oh, that sounds really hard. Oh yes, I really understand, it must be so painful for you. Oh yes, here is some chocolate. Oh, would you like a cup of tea as well? Oh yeah, it's really hard. And can you then go a bit further, please? So they're incredibly kind, and they're really, really unimpressed by any dramas I can present. And this is the other, you can't see it, but it's three people on a scooter where it looks like they're going a bit at a high speed. It's a cartoon, I think, from Disney or something. But sometimes it feels like this to me being on the spiritual path. And I'm the one sort of hanging off the scooter somewhere thinking, this is going a bit too fast, please. And then usually one of my friends who sits ahead of me looks around and says, yeah, but what do you expect? Yeah, so, you know, sometimes just... you know, notice, what do we need? Do we, you know, what is it we need of these? So in the next chapter, Santideva goes on to talk about, well, guarding of awareness. And it is quite a lot in this chapter. I think one of the things I was struck by that he talks about is that he talks a lot about that sense of, well, you know, why is it we get so concerned with the outside world? Why don't we just, you know, work on our minds? And there's that verse number 13, where is there hide to cover the whole world? The wide world can be covered with hide enough for a pair of shoes alone. Yeah, so you only need to sort out your mind. You don't need to sort out the whole world, basically. It's much easier, is what he says. I think sometimes what we want to do is we want to go out and sort the whole world out to fit our minds. And fair enough, yeah. You're in good company, is all I can say. But he does say, in the same way, since I cannot control external events, I will control my own mind. What concern is it of mind whether other things are controlled? So in a way, what he talks about there is, to me, it's a reference to enlightenment. Because it's only when we're enlightened that we are completely unaffected by what happens around us. And, I mean, we're all well on the way, but I'm not there yet. So I think one of the things that is also incredibly helpful in this chapter is he really, really, really draws out and reminds us that we are also incredibly affected by conditions. we are so affected by our inner conditions and we're so affected by our outer conditions. And one way, when I was writing about, you know, well, doing this thing I do when I give a talk, I was sort of thinking, well, how is it we how to guard the mind, really? I mean, he gives some suggestions, but I think in our modern life, we forget sometimes that where we place ourselves really matters to us. So I heard some research about how many miles a day we scroll on our smartphones, and it was just ridiculous. There is something about a bit like with the doubt thing, taking ourselves seriously enough to know that what we do with our time, with our energy, with our mind will have an effect on us as well as on the world. But if I spend my time watching the news and, you know, going to the pub and having idle chatter, that is going to affect my mind in one way. And it might be that, obviously, none of us lives... here it's amazing, isn't it? We're in beautiful surroundings. We're with really kind people. And there's so much of our normal input that's taken away from us. So what a relief. Yeah, what a relief. And in a way that is just like, oh, soak it up, because just walking down the street at home, we will get bombarded with so many impressions. And I think it's quite an art to learn to choose or learn to work with how you don't just let impressions get into your mind. So be discerning about what you are allowing into your mind. I can't remember the exact phrase here. Let's see if I probably put the verse down somewhere here. But, you know, it is really that sense of you don't let... Imagine your mind a bit like a house. And that, what would you like the state of your house to be in? Would you like it to be beautiful and clean and tidy? Well, if you let a horde of three-year-olds in with muddy feet, what is it going to look like? Yeah. And if they've been there, how do you tidy up? So it's a little bit the same with our minds sometimes. If you have to be in surroundings, that can be quite challenging. It's really, you know, Santideva is so adamant, keep your mindfulness, notice, keep your goal alive, notice you are in it for enlightenment. So you might have the three-year-old muddy feet all over the place. And if your intent and your practice is strong enough, that's not going to matter, because your mind will be so big that it doesn't matter what's in it, basically. But for most of us, we will be conditioned. We will be conditioned by we'll be so affected by what we subject our mind to. So you have a choice. You know, what do you want to put into this amazing mind of yours, into your heart? Are you going to, you know... Who of your friends uplift your heart and sort of soothes you and inspires you? And who do you just feel really depressed when you spend time with? Because they're always going on and on about how, you know, stupid other people are, for example. That could be an example. So that sense of, and Santideva talks about that, you know, be really careful if you hang out with people who don't have the same values as you. Because they will try and affect you in the direction that they are interested in. Oh, you don't need to go to the Buddhist center. It's Friday night. Come on. You know. Oh, hey, could you look after your grandchildren? No, grannies don't go on retreat. What are you up to? You're the granny. Come on. you know, and it, I mean, I'm saying this slightly jokingly, but it's so painful when you are in conditions where you really want to love people and you want to meet their needs, but actually their needs is not aligned with your values. So I think sometimes just recognizing the pain that can be in that, and finding your way with, okay, this, I am going to look after my grandchildren this weekend because they really matter to me and my connection with them really matter. Or I am going to go with my friend on this shopping trip because I know for her that's so, that feels like she's, you know, she, it is really important for her, even though I hate the shopping mall and it just goes against my values. I'll do it. So there's a difference of doing something consciously and out of choice and compassion, or feeling you're just subjugated to it. Yeah. Does that make sense? Yeah. And sometimes we do have to do things we don't want to do because we have to earn money, or we live in a, I don't know, country that does stupid things, or, you know, probably all of us live in countries that do stupid things because that's what human beings do. And, you know, we might, part of our jobs might be things that are not as ethical as we would like them to be, or, you know, and it's okay. But there is something about really taking seriously that where we can have a choice and where we can make those choices conscious, just try and do that, you know. And that brings it back to just remembering what is it you want. Because if you want to watch everything that's on Netflix, it's great. Just watch everything that's on Netflix. I don't care, you know. Do you want to gain enlightenment? Well, I do care because I don't think it's going to make you happy in the long run. So it's not that I don't care, but it's your choice. It's your choice. It's your life. No one else decides what you're going to spend your life on. If you're going to spend it on Netflix, that's what you're going to do. The great thing with the Dharma is it says, here is an alternative. Here's an alternative to all the other stuff we are being bombarded with every single day. Here's an alternative that offers freedom. Here's an alternative that offers the end to suffering. Here's an alternative that is so much more radical than you could ever imagine it at this moment in time. Because it's completely mind-blowing. Ooh. I think I quite like that idea. Could I hear a bit more? Yeah. So whenever that stirring arises in us, just really meet it and greet it and love it. Because I really believe every single being, if they get the chance at the right moment, they will be like, yeah, I'd quite like this. I really don't like being caught up in samsara. I don't like the whole, you know, chaos, the fear, the uncertainty, the pain of conditioned existence. I want the other stuff. Yeah. So it comes, you know, just make a choice, really. What do you want? And Santideva talks about the paramitas, which is a standard list of practice. Sometimes they are talked about as 6 paramitas, sometimes as 10. The most standard in Tibetan Buddhism is the 6 paramitas. And the first of those is dana, so generosity. And the second is practicing ethics. And he goes on about that a fair bit. So with these things, it's like thinking, oh yeah, I quite like what you're talking about. How do I then do it? And, you know, Buddhism is full of suggestions of how to actually gain enlightenment. And the paramitas is one of those suggestions. And they are a practice. They are a raft to bring us to the further shore. So none of these paramitas are an end in themselves. they're incredibly helpful because, okay, I quite like this stuff. What do I do? The first one is dana, is practicing generosity. And I think some of the greatest teachings on dana is in Bansai's Vision and Transformation, which now is called the Buddhist Eightfold Path. And he talks about the different levels of dana. Santideva doesn't really go into it in the Bodhicaryavatara, maybe because it's quite implicit in some of the other ways he's talking about, you know, you give your life, you know. The good thing, just a few things about dana, why bother? Why bother practicing generosity? I think one of the great effects is it loosens fear. So practicing generosity loosens fear. Because it sort of eases our sense of separation. If I dare to give something to someone else, I am connecting myself with that being. If I dare to receive something from someone else, I'm opening myself to that being. So it really loosens our sense of separation and it loosens our sense of fear. And it also gives a sense of abundance. There is enough. There is enough. Actually, there's plenty. I was sitting at the breakfast table and I was just suddenly having this experience of there was like jewels being poured behind me. There was this beautiful, beautiful sound. It might have been the cornflakes, but it sounded exactly like it was just jewels being poured out. Yeah. So that sense of, isn't the world just amazing when you are in a safe enough space to appreciate it? And here we have so much amazing beauty, we have quietness, we have amazing people. So that sense of the abundance of, you know, it's when we are in mental states that can actually appreciate what we have, what we can give, what we've been given. It is, oh, it's just amazing. And it's so painful when we are in states that are so closed that we can't appreciate it. Yeah. It's like you probably tried yourself sometimes. We're so closed up that if people want to give us something or help us something, we just see it as a threat. And that's just painful, you know. So just really make the most of it when you are open enough to give, to receive, to appreciate. So the second paramitara is ethics. And on my notes I've written, Buddhist ethics are wonderful. I love ethics. And actually they are. I just think they are blooming amazing, to be honest. Because ethics gives us such a tangible recipe of this is what you can do if you want to start messing your life up.
Yeah.
And honestly, think about if the whole world just practiced the five precepts for a day. Would that be crazy? Yeah. So just how would it be if the whole world was vegetarian for a day? How would it be if the whole world did not lie for a day? How would it be if the whole world did not steal for a day? And we take this for granted once we've been practicing a little bit, but it is mind-blowing, the effect of practicing ethics and keep practicing ethics. It is one of the strongest protections we can have in our practice. Well, why is that? Because we have an instant way of producing less suffering for ourselves and others. Ethics is just, you know, it's a recipe of how to stop producing suffering. Also, I think one of the things that's really helpful is it gives us something to do. It's very practical, and we like things to do. So that sense of practicing is doing something and getting better and better at it. It's not like oh, you've got to be perfect, otherwise I don't talk to you. Buddhism is totally not like that. Buddhism is like, okay, what mess are you in? How can I help you work here? Yeah. So it doesn't matter what a terrible state you might have come from. It's like, okay, what do you do next? And I find that so kind. It's so kind to say whatever you've done in your life, whatever you've experienced in your life, that's fine. Okay, so that's what we work with. What's the first step? Can you practice kindness here? Can you be a bit kinder? Can you be a bit more honest? And I tell you, Buddhism is full of stories of people who have done really, really, really terrible things. And that's just very encouraging. And sometimes I think, you know, I see this, maybe should be a confession, I don't know if that's good to tell you, but sometimes I see someone, you know, signed up to do something, and I think, oh, but you know, they were like all over the place 20 years ago, and oh God, can they really do this? And then I realize, oh yeah, but you know, you were all over the place 20 years ago. You've kept practicing. They've kept practicing. Oh yeah, actually we're contemporaries. So, you know, yeah, you lead retreats and they seem to go okay. So great, this person has actually really made the effort to work on themselves as well. You know, so that's, there's laughing happening. That's good. But there's something about, you know, just trusting practice really, really works. Anyway, where was I going with all that? Da, 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 da. Yeah, it gives us something to do. Anyway, I think also ethics is completely indispensable when we get further and further on the path, because ethics on its own account is going to do a lot of good things for the world, but it's not going to end suffering completely. That is only insight and enlightenment that will do that. And when you practice insight, when you gain more and more loosening of your being, it's incredibly helpful to have these strong habits of ethics in place, because otherwise you can create a complete mess. Mm-hmm. So that sense of wherever you start from, just practice those habits, like the Buddhist history has done, like all of us older members have done. And that sense, I think my point with the story is that it's very encouraging just remembering older members don't start out as these amazing gleaming beings. They start out whatever they turn up with. And then they just make a lot of effort and they keep practicing the Dharma for a long, 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 long time. And make loads of mistakes, and then they get ordained, and then they keep practicing the Dharma and keep making mistakes. It's not different. It just means that there's much more and more momentum. And you know, and there is a lot less suffering and a lot more freedom. So you know, I can only recommend it really. But I also really highly recommend get your ethics in place, because you're going to be in trouble if they're not. So. Just to say, in Santideva's, in the Bodhicaryavatara, he talks a little bit about some of the Vinaya rules, which is quite funny sometimes. The Vinaya is the monastic sort of set of rules which got a bit out of hand. you could say it got a bit out of hand. There's loads of Vinaya rules. And in some traditions, some of the Vinaya rules might still be observed. So in certain traditions, I'm already doing things that would not be very helpful, because I got hair, I got jewelry, and I'm sitting on a chair. That's a high. So, you know, I would have no hair, no jewelry, and sit on the floor. And fair enough, you know, fair enough. You could see how that could have the spirit of just inviting humility and not boosting the ego. And a lot of the Vinaya rules, they are quite, they usually have, there's a point to them. Like, I think there's one like, don't urinate on people's lands and in water with living beings or something. Well, that makes sense because you don't want to urinate on people's vegetables. You know that they're going to eat. It's pretty disgusting. And, you know, there's loads of small things like that. And what the translators suggest they point to is just how discipline can be incredibly good training. And whatever that discipline might be for us, I think there's a lot to be said for discipline. For the first many years I practiced, I turned up to absolutely everything on retreats. And I usually sat on in the evening. And now I'm this lazy person who sometimes sleeps in the morning, you know. But it's, I honestly learned discipline from going on retreat. And what's so fantastic about it is you don't have to think. You just do what your discipline tells you. And it has an effect. So on retreats, there's this program that's carved out for us. You don't have to think, you just turn up. And it just takes that whole debate away about, oh, should I do this, should I not do that, all that. You just do it. And the more you just do it, the more it becomes a habit. So discipline is there's a lot, to me, there's a lot of benefits in deciding on what disciplines you want in your life, because they're going to help you enhance your habits. And that could be like, I'm going to meditate every morning at 7:30 for at least 5 minutes. Yeah. So the Vinaya is funny. And it is not like, oh, you're a bad person if you haven't done this. There's usually some effect that wouldn't be that great if you do it. But the point of the Vinaya is like, it's a training in discipline. And it's the monastic code. Yeah. Okay, so I am gonna finish soon. Yeah, so I think the point, not of the Vinaya, but of the other guarding of the mind in chapter 5 is take care of your mind. And he also says take care of your body. I know he says other things about the body. We'll look at them later in the week. But take care of your mind and body, because these are your vehicles. This is what you've got to work with in this life to gain enlightenment. And there's that beautiful little image of the turtle poking its head up the ocean. And that's like a very, very standard Tibetan tale that the human life is as precious as if there was a turtle living at the bottom of the ocean, only coming up once every 100 years. And there was a yolk on the top of the ocean, and this turtle just happened to put its head through the yolk. Our human life is as unique and precious as if that happened. So basically make the most of it. So I've got a little question for you that you can take if you want. You can just obviously talk about anything. But in terms of making a resolve, a question that sometimes might be interesting to think about is, what stops me? What stops me? And maybe in particular, what stories am I telling myself that stops me? In terms of doubt, you could think, do I actually believe I can do this? Do I have proof? And you could also, just like I have a very strong sense of my spiritual teacher standing right behind me when I'm doing things like this, or at most times, but particularly when I do things like this, who are your spiritual friends? Who are the ones who are cheering on you? Who are the ones that don't buy into your stories, but keep pointing to what you could be? And I'm going to finish with a verse from the Bodhicaryavatara, which is not from this chapter, but I love it, so I'm going to read it anyway. So Santideva says, I am the protector of the unprotected and the caravan leader for travellers. I've become the boat, the causeway, and the bridge for those who long to reach the further shore. May I be a light for those in need of light. May I be a bed for those in need of rest. May I be a servant for those in need of service, for all embodied beings. For embodied beings, may I be the wish-fulfilling jewel, the pot of plenty, the spell that always works, the potent healing herb, the magical tree that grants every wish, and the milk cow that supplies all wants. Just as the earth and other elements are profitable in many ways to the immeasurable beings dwelling throughout space, so may we be sustenance of many kinds for the realm of beings throughout space until all have attained release. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this week's podcast. Please help us keep this free. Make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. And thank you.